Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. This is Anand and you're watching Physics Craze. I have started live sessions also for solving problems and doubt sessions, and I'll be going to take some more live lectures to solve problems because it is very helpful for me also to interact with all of you directly. So what else reason you need to subscribe my channel, yaar? If you haven't subscribed the channel, then do subscribe it and don't forget to press the bell icon so that you will get notified every time I upload a new video. So without wasting too much time, let's get started. So till now we have studied the electric field due to some cases like ring, disk and all of that. But to find the electric field for symmetric cases like sphere, cylinder and all that, we need to understand first the Gauss law. So in this session we'll gonna study the Gauss law and electric flux. Now what is electric flux? Now we all know that electric field lines crosses a surface, then we say that there is electric flux phi e. This is the representation of electric flux phi e through the surface. We know that here we have some diagrams. Now let's consider these are some electric field lines I have shown here. Okay, so these are some electric field lines in the space. Why I have shown three of them? Because we have to understand this relation. So electric flux is surface integration of electric field. It means whatever electric field passing through a given surface, that is called electric flux. Now we need integration to calculate the total electric flux through this total area. So what we do, we just take a small area element of the whole object or of the whole area and we integrate it with the electric field. And here if you'll see, we have dot product. Now what does it mean? It means that here we have, if we write E ds, so we have to write cos theta in the magnitude form. It means there is theta between, or there is some angle between electric field and area vector. Now what is area vector? See, direction of area, how we show the direction of some particular area. So if we have some curved surface, so at any point if we want to show its area vector, so let's consider this point, I want to show the area vector. So what we have to do, we just have to draw a tangent over here, draw tangent, and at that point draw perpendicular to the tangent. So this would be the area vector, or we can say the direction of area of this point only. If we have a flat surface like this, if we have a flat surface, so at any point we know that the tangent will be parallel to the surface and we'll have the direction of that area would be in perpendicular like this. So for curved surface, for flat surface, we need to show the area vector where its direction is. Now why this theta matters? Because let's consider here we have some electric field lines and we have some cases. This is case 1, this is case 2 and this is case 3. So I have a ring, let's consider I have a ring. Now in this case I have placed that ring in vertical format like this. It means a maximum electric field is passing through this area. So we can say the angle between, if we'll say the angle between area vector and electric field would be zero. Why? Because here the area vector of this disk would be in this direction. So we can say electric field and area vector both are parallel to each other, so theta would be zero. So what does it mean? It means a maximum flux passing through this ring. Now in the second case, let me just tilt my ring up to some angle or some factor like this. Now this is my ring and this is its area. So now the area vector of this ring would be in this direction, perpendicular to the surface, but electric field is in this direction, so we have some angle between them, see. And from the figure we can also say that the flux which was flowing through this area and the flux which is flowing through this area, both are different, or we can say this flux is less than this one. Now in third case, if I just flip my ring or that area horizontal to the electric field, what we can say that here flux would be zero because none of the electric field is passing through that surface, perpendicular to that surface or some angle. They are moving parallel to the surface. Or we can also say that mathematically the area vector of this surface would be in this direction or downward, whatever, and electric field is in this direction. So see, the angle between them is 90 degree, and we know that cos 90 is what? cos 90 is 0, it means total flux would be 0. So this is how we calculate electric flux. Now what is Gauss law? We know that Gauss law represent a relationship between electric charge and electric field. It means if we have some charge distribution, we can calculate electric field using Gauss law. Now what does Gauss law say? It says that total electric flux through a closed surface, just remember this word, we need a closed surface, it means a packed surface, is equal to charge enclosed by that surface. Whatever charge it encloses inside that surface, whatever we are considering the surface, the charges that are inside that surface, we only consider those charges and divided by epsilon naught, which is permittivity of free space. So we can write this E dot ds, or we can write flux through the closed surface can be written as E dot ds, and here we have some little sign here. See, here we have this integration sign. This integration means we have closed surface integration. What we have? Closed surface integration. And we can relate this flux through Q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. Now this electric field here, whatever we have written here E, this electric field is due to all charges. Now let me just give some diagrammatical representation so that you will get more clear view. So let's consider we have this sphere of some radius r, and we have some charge distribution all over the sphere. Now we want to calculate the electric field inside somewhere here. Let me just zoom it inside somewhere here. So what we'll do, we will use a Gaussian surface. First of all, this is basic, we all have done in 11th and 12th. We need a Gaussian surface and we have to calculate. Now see this Gaussian surface, it means this is 3D Gaussian surface, okay? So it is a closed surface. So we can use now this Gauss law equation, and from that we can write E dot ds integration of closed surface equals to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. Now what I want to explain here, that the electric field that we'll find here at this point, this electric field would be due to all the charges of this sphere, not only the enclosed charge, but in the relation we use Q enclosed only. So it doesn't mean that the electric field is due to this enclosed charge. Do you understand? This electric field is due to all charges, whatever charge we have inside the Gaussian surface and outside the Gaussian surface. That is it. I want to clear with all of you that the electric field is due to all the charges, but in the relation we use only Q enclosed. Now using Gauss divergence theorem, what is Gauss divergence theorem? We know that according to Gauss divergence theorem, we can convert a surface integral. We can convert a surface integral into a volume integral. Now let's consider we have a surface, closed surface, and we have some vector A which is passing through this surface. So this A dot ds, closed integral of A dot ds, we can write it as divergence of A into dv. Divergence of A into dv. This is the, we can say, mathematical statement of Gauss divergence theorem. So here also we can use Gauss divergence theorem because we have closed surface integral. Now this integration or this relation we have from Gauss divergence theorem. So what we can write here, we can write del dot E, or we can say divergence of E dv. This thing we can write using Gauss divergence theorem, and here we can write 1 over epsilon naught rho dv. Now how did I write this Q enclosed into rho dv? See, we have a closed surface, it means a volume charge density. So we know that rho equals to dq divided by dv. From my previous videos, we have got that relation and we can write dq as rho dv. So Q enclosed or Q total, what we can write? Integration of rho dv. So from this relation, I have directly put this value. So what we can write now, we have to, so from this equate the both side of this equation, and what we can write here, we have integration of dv, integration of dv. So from this we can write del dot E, what we can write, del dot E or divergence of E is equals to rho divided by epsilon naught. So here see, we have the integration form or integral form of Gauss divergence theorem, and here we have differential form of Gauss divergence theorem. This is differential form, del dot E. We know that del dot E we can write del as, here mathematically what we can write, what equation we have got, del dot E equals to rho by epsilon naught. So mathematically we can write this divergence as dou by dou x I cap plus dou by dou y j cap plus dou by dou z k cap, and this would be dot product with E. So here see, we have written the Gauss law in terms of differentiation, that's why it is called a differential form of Gauss law. So this helps us to calculate divergence at any point, and always remember the point where we want to calculate divergence of E, we want to calculate divergence of E of a point, let's consider in a question, so we have to use rho of that point, it means charge distribution of that point. Now let's consider here we have a sphere which has some charge distribution and the total charge is Q, and we have the radius of sphere as R. What we have to calculate? We have to calculate divergence of E inside and outside. So here for inside, what we can write? For inside we can write del dot E as rho by epsilon naught. So at inside, at any point, we can say at any point, rho can be written as total charge divided by total volume. This is V means volume, and what we have volume of the sphere as 4 by 3 pi r cube, and this is epsilon naught. So we can write 3q over 4 pi r cube epsilon naught for inside. Now for outside, at any point here, see, at this point let's consider we have rho equals to 0, so what we can say, divergence of E would be 0. Now what does this mean? It means that whatever flux coming or whatever flux entering into this small area, the same amount of flux is going outward. So let's move ahead. Some important points are there. Now we have this relation, this integral form of Gauss law, E dot ds equals to Q enclosed by epsilon naught. See, just remember that if Q enclosed is 0, it means electric field may or may not be 0 at that point. And if enclosed, Q enclosed is 0, then E would be 0 only for 3 symmetric cases. Now what are these 3 symmetric cases? I'll explain this one in couple of minutes. Just first study what are these 3 symmetric cases. So the first symmetric case is spherical symmetry. Spherical symmetry means we must have charge distribution or uniform charge distribution around the center. It means if we have a surface or if we have a sphere like this, so the charge distribution that we have in the surface or outside the sphere, that charge distribution should be same around this center. It means whatever charges we have left side, the same amount of charge we should have on right side. Whatever charges we have in the upper side of this center, the same amount of charge we should have at the lower side of this center. So if we have some charge distribution like this, that from all the perspective the charge distribution is same around this center, so we'll say that distribution as spherical symmetry. So from that, what we can write, rho should be constant. It means volume charge density should be constant at each point, the charges should be same. And for the surface we can write sigma should be constant. For the surface charge density, what we can, sigma should be constant. It means this rho or sigma should not depend on theta or phi. They should not depend on theta or phi. Now the second symmetric case is cylindrical symmetry. So if we have a cylinder like this, and this is the axis of the cylinder, let's consider. So from this axis also, if we have some rho or some sigma charge distribution in the volume and in the surface, so we should have those charge distribution as constant around this axis. It means whatever charge we have on the right hand side of this axis like this, let's consider at this distance r, the same amount of charge should be on the left hand side also at the same distance. So this kind of distribution is called cylindrical symmetry. And what is plane symmetry? Plane symmetry, it means we have a surface, so for that surface we will always write sigma equals to constant. It means the surface charge distribution should be same on the surface of plane, given plane. So these three symmetrical cases that we have studied, only in these cases, if q enclosed is 0 at some point or at some volume, we will write E equals to 0 at that point. So for example, let's consider we have these two spheres. This is my case 1 and this is my case 2. In this, we have rho equals to constant in both of these spheres. But here we have cavity. This is called cavity. It means we have cut out some portion from these spheres. So in this first case, we have cavity at the center. And on the second case, we have cavity somewhere in the sphere. So in first case, if you'll see, if I just take some distance from the center, let's consider this is small r. So whatever charge it has, on the left hand side, if I just take the same distance r, we'll have the same amount of charge, or up and down, whatever, where. If we just take the small distance r on the whole sphere, at this equal distance, we'll have the same charge distribution. So here we can say that E would be 0 inside this cavity because there is no charge. But in the second case, if you'll see, here we have cavity in this point. Now from the center, if I just take the distance r, let's consider inside this cavity. So here we have no charge, but on the opposite side, if I just take the same distance, we have some charge distribution here. So it means it is not symmetrically placed. So for non-symmetric cases, if q enclosed is 0, here in this cavity we have no charges, but here E will not be 0. Understand? So that is what I wanted to explain you with these two points. So let's move ahead with some of the examples to calculate electric flux. One more thing is there. Let's consider we have a sphere, and in that sphere we don't have any charge, not in the volume and not on the surface. And outside this sphere we have some charge q. So we know that the electric field would be like this through this sphere. So in this also, if you just see from the center at this distance, from the center, if I just take this distance, this much of distance, we have some charge q. But on the right hand side, do we have any charge? No, we don't have any charge. So what we can say, this is not symmetric case. This is not symmetric case. So what we can say, the electric field inside this sphere would not be zero. But flux would be zero because flux is called q enclosed divided by epsilon naught. So here we don't have any charge inside this sphere. So flux through this sphere would be zero. But electric field through this sphere or on the surface inside this sphere, we have non-zero electric field because it is non-symmetric case. It is non-symmetric case. So let's move ahead with some of the example. We have to calculate the electric flux for this given problems. The first case is we have some area here. If you'll see this area, and what we can say, the area is drawn on the xy plane, and here we have electric field in the z direction. So we have to calculate flux through this area. So flux, what we have the formula, flux is E dot ds. Now see, E is uniform here, we know that, and ds, it means we have to write the area vector. So from this diagram, what we can say, this area vector would be either in positive z or either in negative z, whatever we can write. But for simplicity, we'll consider the area vector in the positive z direction. Why? Because our electric field is also in positive z direction. So we can write E as E is the magnitude, and what we can write, ds, small area, and here we have the direction of electric field is z cap, and the direction of area element was also in z cap. So this z dot z would be 1, and we'll have integration of electric field ds only. Now E is uniform, so we can take E outside, and this would be integration of ds. And what is the integration of ds? Means total area, and what we have total area as E a square, because this is what we have square. So we can write the total area as a square. So this is the flux through this surface. Now this second case is very important. This second case is very important, as per the examination purpose. Here we have some area, and here we have electric field somewhere in positive I, j and k cap. Here alpha, beta and gamma, they are constant. Now what we have to do, we have to find flux through the surface. So we know the formula, it is E dot ds. I'm not writing here closed integration because we don't have a closed volume, we just have normal flux integration. So electric field is given as this. We have to find the small area element and direction of that element. So here if you'll see, if I just say this is my first vector and this is my second vector, let's consider the sides of my this square. This is my first vector and this is my second vector. So if I just take the cross product of these two vector, so we'll have the direction of this area element in this. So let us say this is my area, this is my vector A and this is my vector B. So if I just take A cross B, now we know that the cross product gives another vector which is perpendicular to plane of A and B. So this would be the third vector, and here we can say from the diagram this would be the direction of this area. So what we have to calculate, we have to calculate A vector and B vector. So let us solve A vector and B vector. So A vector can be written as C, this length is A and from x axis it is making angle phi. So we can write A vector as A cos phi I cap plus A sin phi j cap. I have just taken the components of this length. And what about B? Vector B, here it has length A and it is having direction only in Z. So we can write A k cap directly. So here we had A bar, or we can say A vector and B vector. So from this we can write, since E is constant, so we can write this is as E dot integration of ds. So we can write E dot integration of ds means whole area. So area would be, let's consider S. Here we have E vector and we have to calculate S vector. So from this explanation we can write S vector as A cross B or B cross A, whatever you can write. So A cross B, what we'll have, we'll have I cap, J cap, K cap. Here we have A cos phi, A sin phi, and here we'll have 0, this is 0, 0 and A. So we have to calculate this A cross B and you will get S vector. And after that you will have to calculate the dot product of E and S. So you will get the value of flux passing through this surface. So this question is very important. So just remember the technique that we have used here to calculate the area vector, and in all of the questions like this you have to do this procedure only. So yes, this is it for today guys, and in the next video we'll going to cover some more examples on flux, and there are some tricks involved to calculate flux through the closed surface. We'll cover that portion in the next video. Until then, best of luck and take care.